friends. First of all, I'd like to welcome everybody. Looking around, I can see quite a number of familiar faces. In fact, quite a few very familiar faces. I can also see a few faces that aren't quite so familiar to me, and a very few that aren't familiar at all. But familiar, not so familiar, very familiar, I welcome you all this evening to our commemoration of the 30th death anniversary of Bhimrao Ramji Ambedkar. This is, as a matter of fact, the first time that this particular anniversary, the anniversary of the death of Dr. Ambedkar, has been publicly celebrated in London by the Friends of the Western Buddhist Order. But though this is the first time that that anniversary has been publicly celebrated, nonetheless, there is a very close connection between the FWBO in the West and the Buddhist movement inaugurated in India by Dr. Ambedkar some 30 years ago, shortly before his death. I myself, as many of you know, spent some 20 years in India, and in the course of those 20 years I came to know Dr. Ambedkar himself personally, and after his death I had quite an extensive contact with many of his followers all over, especially central and western India. It so happened indeed that on the very day of his death, almost exactly 30 years ago, I happened to be in Nagpur, which is at the almost exactly geographical center of India, and on that occasion when the quite stunning and startling news of his death in Delhi arrived, I was the witness to the tremendous grief and sense of loss on the part of hundreds of thousands of his devoted followers. And observing their grief on that occasion, I could feel what Ambedkar meant to them. I could feel what he had done for them, because we mustn't forget that his followers were mostly untouchables. They occupied the very lowest stratum of the Indian social system. They were despised and rejected by all the hundreds and thousands of castes above them, and their condition in all respects, social, economic, educational, even religious, was about as low as one could possibly imagine. And in the course of his public career, Ambedkar had lifted them out of the depths of degradation into which they had sunk, or into which they had been pushed, one might say, and they were correspondingly grateful. And even though Ambedkar had done so much for them and done so much for so many people over a period of so many years, even though he is, we may say, one of the very greatest men of modern India, very little is known about him in the West. One might even say that very little is known about him nowadays in India itself, outside the circles of his own actual followers. It seems to me that in India itself, though leaders like Mahatma Gandhi and Pandit Nehru and several others are given their due recognition, as yet Ambedkar, even though he was the framer of the Indian Constitution, has not yet been given his meed of recognition. That being the case, it is perhaps hardly surprising that he shouldn't be particularly well known in the West, not even perhaps in this country. And this is one of the reasons why we've organized this commemoration, this meeting, because we feel that Ambedkar, for all sorts of reasons, on all sorts of counts, should be very much better known than he is, not only in India, but in the West, and especially perhaps here in England. So this evening we're going to have talks, and we're going to have a symposium by three people, three members of the Western Buddhist Order. That is to say, Nagabodhi, Vajraketu and Virabhadra. They've all spent time in India. I'd almost said they'd all done time in India. Because the conditions under which they have had to live and work were in some cases of appalling difficulty. One of them, I won't mention his name because I want to spare his blushes, didn't even have a place to stay for a whole year. He used to sleep in odd corners wherever he could. And with the odd corner as his headquarters, he addressed meetings and led retreats and so on and so forth, all over Greater Bombay and beyond. So they've all had some experience. They've all seen, they've all met, they've all lived with, they've all worked with these ex-untouchable followers of Dr. Ambedkar, who are now Buddhists, as well as with many others from all sections of society. And this evening, they're going to share some of their experiences with us. I say some of their experiences because I know that they've all had a very vast, a very rich experience of Dr. Ambedkar's movement and his followers in India. And in the space of just 20 or 30 minutes, they're not going to be able to tell us very much. But they're going to be able to tell us, I hope, enough to whet our appetites and excite our interest in the great man whose death we're commemorating, in his millions upon millions of unfortunate followers. And I hope they will be able to forge, or perhaps just to strengthen, the link which exists between them and us. First comes Nagabodhi. The name of Nagabodhi is already a name to conjure with, no, not just in England, not just in Great Britain, but in places like Bombay and Pune, because Nagabodhi has been to India twice, he's been there with me, and he's also spent 6 months there working on a book. And I think tens of thousands of our Indian friends there know he's working on this book, and they know it's about them. They're quite interested. And even though that book isn't about us, well, we're quite interested too. I've had the good fortune to actually read the typescript of that book, and I must say it's really fascinating, and I hope that we shall see it in print. But I mustn't say anything more. Perhaps I should just make way for our first speaker, Nagabodhi.
Mr. Chairman and friends, tonight we're celebrating two things, really. In particular, and especially, we're celebrating an anniversary. But we are also celebrating a new book, the launching of a new book. The anniversary, as we've just heard, is the 30th anniversary of the death of Dr. Bhimrao Ramji Ambedkar. The book is entitled Ambedkar and Buddhism. It's not, by the way, my book. It's a book by our chairman, Sangharakshita. And it's a book that explains how and why Dr. Ambedkar began a movement of mass conversion, how and why he brought Buddhism back to its native land, to the land of its birth. Now, as Sangharakshita just said, in the West, Dr. Ambedkar is hardly known. Before I went to India, on both occasions, I would talk with friends, relatives, who would ask me why I was going. And in explaining my reasons, I would mention the name of Dr. Ambedkar, because in some way he was crucial to the movement that I was going out to observe and participate in. Nobody had ever heard of him. Nobody that I spoke to ever had heard of him. I've looked in various encyclopedias. I have managed to find entries in Western encyclopedias, but they're very brief entries, maybe a couple of paragraphs. They perhaps portray him as a fairly minor political figure, a minor character from a vast historical drama, a man who attended the Round Table conferences on India's independence in London during the 30s, the man who became India's first law minister immediately after independence, the man who chaired the committee which created the constitution of the newly independent India. He's perhaps also mentioned as a man who campaigned for human rights, for the social, economic, political advancement of the untouchables, a man who struggled in a strange alien world of caste, untouchability, the idea of ritual pollution, in a strange world of graded inequality and degradation. For Westerners, this is a very difficult world to understand. It's a very difficult world to believe in. I remember when I studied the subject at school, and there would be maybe two classes during the course of my school days devoted to Hinduism, and there would be some mention of the caste system. It simply seemed rather strange and alien to me. But this is the world that Ambedkar came from and worked in and struggled in. A very different world, a very Indian world. So perhaps it's not surprising that he's not well known in the West. In my opinion, this is a shame. This is a sad thing. I also think it's in some ways unfair. Dr. Ambedkar is an important figure in history. He was a man of immense stature. And in this century of ours, preoccupied as we seem to be with notions of human rights, where history is spattered with revolutions and radical social changes, Ambedkar is a man of far-reaching and universal significance and relevance. He was a social visionary. He was a revolutionary in the best and highest sense of the word. He's a man from whom all of us have much to learn. Now, in India, there are many people who already believe this, to whom I don't have to explain this. These are people who revere him and venerate him. Now, had you been in Bombay last week, on the 6th of December, which is the actual date of the anniversary of his death, it would have been worth your while going along to a place called Dadar Chowpatty. It's a very large, odoriferous beach on the edge of Bombay. If you tried to go there, if you'd got the local to Dadar and then walked through the bazaar along the streets towards this beach, you would have found it difficult to walk because the road would have been so thick with people coming and going. When you finally get to the beach, you wouldn't see sand, you wouldn't see pebbles. You'd see nothing but stalls and people. Stalls selling food. Stalls giving away water. Stalls where you could buy posters and photographs and medallions. And all the posters and all the photographs and all the medallions show pictures of Dr. Ambedkar just a face, or maybe a tableau about his life. There would be bookstalls, many, many, many bookstalls, selling books by Dr. Ambedkar, selling books about Dr. Ambedkar, in English, in Hindi, in Marathi, in Gujarati, in Telugu, and so on. There would be stages erected all over the place, where people would be giving talks, where musicians would be reciting, perhaps where monks would be ordaining people. And there would be music everywhere, blasting out of loudspeakers, tinny loudspeakers, sort of pop songs about Dr. Ambedkar. And above all, had you been there, you would not have been alone, because you would have found yourself in a crowd of about 1 million people. And that would be just one meeting in one town, admittedly one of the larger ones, but there would be similar meetings taking place in other major cities around Maharashtra, in some other states beyond. And you would find equally large crowds gathered on other occasions throughout the year. And these people who you would be milling with are Dr. Ambedkar's followers. To them, Dr. Ambedkar was no mere figure from history, even though he's been dead these 30 years. Dr. Ambedkar was, and is, a champion and the embodiment of a myth. He was the boy born in the mud of untouchability, whose very touch could pollute another human being, who was forced to live on the fringes of the village or on the fringes of the town, drinking the filthiest water, using the filthiest water to wash in, being told what to wear, how to dress, and so on. And the boy who from that background managed to fight and win himself an education and a career as a lawyer and a barrister. He was a boy who would be refused by a barber. No barber would cut his hair. People wouldn't even give him a lift on their bullock carts for fear of pollution. He wasn't allowed to sit in the classrooms at school, but had to sit outside. And yet, he became a great leader of his people, a great statesman. He was a man who devoted his entire adult life to the uplift of his fellows. He founded newspapers. He founded societies, unions, and political parties. He established colleges and hostels. And he fought for the rights, for human rights, and for social equality, and for religious freedom. As a politician, he spoke for millions of untouchable people, and he won important concessions and important safeguards which have survived right down to the present day. All in all, he played a crucial role in the process which finally made untouchability something beyond the law, and which hopefully in time will have finally relegated it to being something from history. But Ambedkar's career, this mythic career, which just in itself is enough to inspire people, even now, concluded by entering a completely different dimension. It entered the dimension of religion, the dimension of religious conversion. And it's this dimension to his career which gives Ambedkar a far wider significance than his political or social work afforded. It also is the reason why we are here tonight, particularly celebrating the anniversary of his death. Just a little while before he died, Ambedkar converted to Buddhism. Just a few years before he converted, he made it clear that he was thinking of converting to Buddhism. Not everybody took him seriously. They didn't take him seriously when he declared his intention. They didn't take him seriously when he performed the act. Very few people understood what he was trying to do. They saw it as a political stunt. They believed that he was just an old man, an old politician, seeking attention, seeking the limelight for one last time. Some even suspected that he was going senile, turning soft. How can you challenge injustice? How can you overthrow a millennium of degradation with religion? How could religion possibly offer a solution to the ills of Indians' depressed masses? Ambedkar could have begun a revolution, a stormy, violent political revolution. He was the undisputed leader of the tens of millions of untouchables in India. If he'd said the word, he could have brought bloodshed of an unprecedented order to India. But he didn't want that. He honestly believed that religion held the key, the real key to lasting social change. After all, it was Hinduism, a religion which had sanctioned and even to some extent, a large extent, created caste and untouchability and all the degradation and oppression that went with it. Religion, on the other hand, could offer moral guidance, a moral foundation. In his mind, morality provided the indispensable foundation of any truly human society. Now, by religion, he didn't mean something which constellated around a god. In his mind, religion was about what is best and most truly human and most healthy in man, in mankind. It was not necessarily about gods. He believed that religion and religious practice offered the key to the innate riches, the innate wisdom of the human being. Religion offered the vision, the idealism, and the wisdom which in time could perhaps give birth to a new society without violence, without any need for violence. Obviously, a religion that could do this, that could transform society in this way, couldn't be any old religion. It had to be the right religion. He had his criteria. He believed in religion. He believed in the effectiveness and the power of religion, the religious mood of man, the religious aspect or side of man. But the religion that would change society would have to be a religion that accorded with science, that couldn't be controverted by reason or scientific investigation. It had to be adaptable and relevant in a scientific age. It had to uphold the virtues of liberty, of equality and fraternity. These, in his mind, were not merely political virtues. He once said, "People think I speak of these virtues because I've studied in the West." Because he did. He studied in London and in America. "They think I've picked up ideas of liberty, equality and fraternity from politics, from the French Revolution." But these are spiritual virtues. These are virtues that have direct bearing on what is most important, what is most deep and true in man. And the right religion, the religion that would provide a basis for a transformation of society, obviously had to be a religion which did not sanction or ennoble poverty. He and his untouchable friends had enough of that. So he investigated the religions of the world. He investigated, obviously, the religions that were already thriving in India. There was Sikhism, Islam, Christianity. All of them had their own communities, their own universities, their own temples, their own teachers, their own political power bases. But he rejected them. One by one, they failed to meet these criteria that I just mentioned. And in the end, the only religion that did meet his criteria was Buddhism, a dead religion, a religion that had died out in India a thousand years before. It was very much alive in Burma, in Thailand, in Sri Lanka, but in India, where he was and where his followers were, it was considered to be a dead religion. No political power, no money. There was no advantage whatsoever in any material sense of converting to Buddhism. But it provided that key to him. It was the religion that met his criteria, and religion, in his view, was a transforming agent, a catalyst for a new society. And so he decided to convert, and he decided to persuade the rest of the untouchable population to convert with him. His vision was to see 50, 60 untouchable people converting to Buddhism, forsaking Hinduism, forsaking the caste system, just throwing off the whole notion of untouchability. And then, by practicing Buddhism, by really practicing it, developing self-respect, developing qualities of generosity, developing an ethical sense, developing so many human virtues, making themselves better, living better lives. And slowly, very, very slowly, and he admitted it would be a very long and devious path, and slowly transforming society by their actions and by their example. And when I say this, although I've been able to do almost nothing in terms of communicating to you the essence of Ambedkar's career, please believe me, this man was no idle dreamer. He'd spent decades fighting political battles, fighting with the British, fighting with the Hindus, fighting with anybody who got in his way, trying to win rights, trying to win power, trying to organize. This was a hard-headed, pragmatic politician, a hard-headed, realistic social revolutionary. This man was no dreamer. And the culminating vision of his career was the vision of mass conversion to Buddhism as a practical manifesto of social change. So it was a unique vision, and it could have led to a unique experiment. But within weeks of converting, just 7 weeks after converting, Dr. Ambedkar died on December the 6th, 1956, just 30 years ago. He had managed to persuade many of his followers from his own particular subcaste to join him. The movement had begun, but he had not done anything like the work he intended to do. So what happened? What became of his vision? Did it just fade and die with him? Well, I'm not going to tell you. I'm going to pass you on in a moment to Vajraketu, who will take the story on from where I will now leave it off.
Nagabodhi must be a thought reader, because his last two sentences were the very two sentences of introduction to Vajraketu that I was going to say. But never mind. We're used to that sort of thing. I'm sure you'll agree with me that Nagabodhi has given us a very inspiring glimpse of the life of Ambedkar. In fact, a very inspiring glimpse of Ambedkar himself. And he's brought us through his life up to the time of his conversion, and then almost immediately afterwards, only 6 weeks later, his unfortunate and untimely death. So what happened after that? Well, not exactly after that, but what happened some time after that, we're going to hear from Vajraketu's personal experience.
And friends. As we've already heard, this is the first time that we in the FWBO have organised a public function to celebrate the memory of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. I'm sure it will have struck many people as a rather strange thing to do. But it does not seem strange to me, for the principal festivals associated with Dr. Ambedkar are stamped very strongly in my mind. His birth on April the 14th, his conversion to Buddhism on October the 14th, his death on December the 6th. In Maharashtra, the state in Western India where I lived and worked, each of these anniversaries was the occasion of huge celebratory festivals, which lasted at least 2 days. The birth anniversary on April the 14th would last 4 or 5 days, the celebrations associated with it. People would decorate their homes. They'd prepare special food. They'd perform extra pujas, that is, extra Buddhist devotional practices. They would visit sites associated with Dr. Ambedkar. Nagabodhi mentioned Dada Chowpatty, the biggest site in Bombay where the ashes of Dr. Ambedkar are contained in a stupa. As he said, 1 million people would go there on the day of a Dr. Ambedkar festival. Wherever there was a statue of Dr. Ambedkar, people would gather. They would garland it with flowers, so by the end of the day, the statue would be literally buried under hundreds and hundreds of garlands of flowers. Wherever possible on a festival, they would organise a programme. A programme is something somewhat akin to what we have this evening. It's an event with talks where special attempts are made to decorate wherever it's to take place. And people are invited to talk on Dr. Ambedkar, to talk on Buddhism. In Bombay, where I lived, all through the year, we would get more invitations to speak than we could possibly deal with. But at the time of festivals, both the festivals associated with Dr. Ambedkar and the more specifically Buddhist festivals, at those times we'd be absolutely inundated with requests, invitations, people often literally pleading with us to come to their locality to give a talk on some aspect of Buddhism. So usually I would do 2 or perhaps 3 talks on the eve of the festival and 3 or 4 on the day of the festival itself, tearing around Bombay on local trains and buses, cramming in everything in Bombay. There isn't enough of it. There aren't enough trains, there aren't enough buses, there aren't enough houses, there aren't enough roads. So everything is a problem. We'd be just tearing, scrambling onto buses, going from one place to another. I would go, I would have a translator. There would be people coming along selling, carrying books, who would set up bookstalls and sell them at each place where we gave a talk. There would be people who were also going to speak at the same time. At each place we would arrive, we would set up this bookstall, much as we've set up a bookstall here, in fact. We would be invited into somebody's house. Perhaps we would be fed, at least we would have tea and snacks while people gathered for the programme. Then the programme would start. There would be speeches of welcome. I would be garlanded. Then I would be given garlands, and I would garland the picture or the statue of the Buddha. I would garland the picture of Dr. Ambedkar. I would give a talk. Somebody else would give talks. At the end, just as the end here, there would be a push for people to buy books. I don't know that everything that Sangharakshita has written, but a great deal that Sangharakshita has written has been translated into Marathi, and we make a big point of trying to spread these as far as possible. So everywhere we go, we would set up bookstalls and try and sell them. Inevitably, when this was happening, we would get behind schedule and turn up for the last program, it would be midnight. And still there would be several hundred people patiently waiting for us. So even though it was midnight, we would still go ahead, we would give our talks, we would go through the appropriate ceremonies, getting home at perhaps 2 or 3 in the morning, and then having to be up again early the next day to get off for the next program, which would be, say, 9:30 in the morning. At each festival, I would swear never to try to do this so much next time, because we used to just get exhausted. But somehow, as each new festival arrived, the same would happen. People were so keen to hear us speak, so keen to hear the Dharma, the teaching of the Buddha, that it was just impossible to say no. That these talks were not given in splendid Buddhist temples. They were not even in hired halls like this. They were mostly on waste ground, or on rubbish heaps by the side of the road, or in the corridors of tenement blocks. Anywhere in that overcrowded city where you could find enough space to fit several hundred people. Wherever people could gather, they would organize a program. Usually they would be organized by a particular locality. And great trouble would have been expended to make the normally dingy surroundings look as attractive and bright and cheerful as possible, with fairy lights draped over the hutments. A shrine would be erected, perhaps a makeshift stage out of bamboo poles and planks, and be covered with coloured material and brightly coloured mats. All this trouble, all this activity, can be traced back to the conversion of Dr. Ambedkar to Buddhism in 1956 that Nagabodhi introduced us to. It is hard at first for a Westerner to appreciate the depth of feeling amongst the ex-untouchables for Dr. Ambedkar. It is something without parallel in our culture. I found it hard to appreciate it myself when I first arrived in India. I remember very clearly the first public talk that I gave. Before the talk, I was asked to garland a picture of Dr. Ambedkar. I remember feeling quite awkward. So I hung this garland over a picture of Dr. Ambedkar. A chubby, rather severe-looking man in a baggy Western suit. And I just wondered, well, what would my friends think if they could see me doing this? I was bowing respectfully to an almost unknown Indian. I did it because it was expected of me. And I had gone to India with as open a mind as possible. But I did feel awkward. But as I came to understand Dr. Ambedkar better, I came to see what he had, and as I came to see what he had done and what he represented to my new friends, I felt less awkward at showing him reverence. His picture is in every Buddhist home. His photo or bust adorns every shrine. His statue stands at the entrance of many Buddhist localities. His name is the favored greeting whenever Buddhists meet. Whenever Buddhists meet, they join palms together and say Jaya Bhim, which means victory to Bhimrao, victory to Dr. Ambedkar. So I found it progressively easier to show him respect, at first out of feelings of solidarity with my new friends. But eventually I found myself sharing these feelings of reverence as I came to understand what a great man Dr. Ambedkar had been. It was an awareness of that greatness that led several million ex-untouchables to follow Dr. Ambedkar out of Hinduism and into Buddhism, even though very few of them fully appreciated the significance of what they were doing. It is a great tragedy that he died just 6 weeks after this conversion, after his own conversion, before he had had a chance to explain fully why he had chosen Buddhism, and before he had been able to arrange the education in this new life that his followers would need. After his death, there was a good deal of confusion. Almost all those who converted were poor. Many were illiterate. They came from a background of untouchability, which fostered in them feelings of inferiority and fear. Practically all they had, their one asset, was this tremendous faith in Dr. Ambedkar, a faith so strong that it transferred easily to a faith in the path which he had chosen, the path of Buddhism. This was not blind faith. Though in India, the mass conversions were often dismissed as just acts of blind faith. In Buddhism, faith plays an important part, but faith based upon reason and experience. The ex-untouchables had before them the example of Dr. Ambedkar, an untouchable himself, who had achieved so much, who had devoted his whole life to their uplift, who had chosen Buddhism as the means for their emancipation, They had every reason to want to follow this path, because everything that Dr. Ambedkar had done in his life had contributed to their economic, social and spiritual advancement. This is not to say that everything proceeded smoothly. It didn't. As I said, there was a great deal of confusion after his death. Dr. Ambedkar chose Buddhism for the spiritual qualities it possessed, not for its organizational strength, which in India at the time was almost non-existent. Nagabodhi mentioned that in 1956 Buddhism was virtually dead in India. The new movement that he had started lacked leadership and direction. But it was made up of millions of people who, through their faith in Dr. Ambedkar, had a high level of receptivity to Buddhism and who were not going to be easily deterred. People who could read got hold of books on Buddhism. People tracked down teachers, they tracked down monks, anyone who might know something about Buddhism. It was a story I heard again and again from my friends in India, this constant search for the reason why Dr. Ambedkar chose Buddhism, the frustration of years and years of blind alleys, and the noble attempts to practice unguided. Let me tell you just about one example. A friend of mine in Bombay called Chandrasila. He told me how for years and years he just read everything he could get hold of about Buddhism. He went to every lecture he could. He met every monk. There were very, very few monks in India. He would travel miles and miles if he heard one was in a nearby town to meet him, to hear what he had to say. He was always searching for some vital element that he knew that must be there. His logic was quite simple. Dr. Ambedkar must have chosen Buddhism for a good reason, so I will find that reason. It was only on coming on his first retreat with us in Bombay that he found what he was looking for. What we might call living Buddhism. He said, and I remember this very clearly, he said it felt like coming home after long and lonely wanderings. It's 5 years since that retreat. Chandrasila is now an order member. He has established a Buddhist center in the suburb of Bombay in which he lives. He has gathered about him other committed Buddhists, and together they have started a hostel for deprived children and a cooperative business to help support help fund that hostel. In his introduction, Sangharakshita mentioned that he had been in Nagpur at the time of Dr. Ambedkar's death. What he didn't mention was that for seven years after that, he spent every winter traveling all over Western India, teaching Buddhism, exhorting people to keep alive the spirit of Dr. Ambedkar through their practice of Buddhism. I hope one day that we will hear in detail his memories of that time. I myself have visited several villages, apparently in the middle of nowhere, where Sangharakshita had been 25 years before me, and where his visit is still remembered. For many, it may well have been the only time that they had heard the Dharma, that they had heard the Buddha's teachings explained. But Sangharakshita had no backup, no support, no way of following up the contacts that he made. Eventually he returned to England to found the Friends of the Western Buddhist Order, all the while keeping up contact with his friends in India, so that when one of his early disciples, named Lokamitra, decided to return to India to carry on Sangharakshita's work, he found a network of friends and sympathizers eager to help him. Lokamitra started in Pune, where I joined him at the beginning of 1982. Pune is the second largest city in the state of Maharashtra, Bombay being the biggest. It was there that I met Bodhi Sen, a man of my own age, who had been a packer in a factory in Bombay until he had heard about Lokamitra's activities in Pune. He persuaded Lokamitra to come to Bombay to give some talks. They became friends, and Bodhi Sen gave up his job and moved to Pune in order to have more contact. Bodhi Sen had no education. He had left his village and moved to the overcrowded squalor of Bombay so that he could send money back to his family, who were, like most ex-untouchables, landless agricultural labourers. When I first met Bodhi Sen, he could speak no English. But within a year, he was translating talks for me from English into the local language Marathi. It was he who persuaded me to return with him to Bombay to establish Buddhist activities there. Bombay is full of people like Bodhi Sen, that there are actually a million ex-untouchable Buddhists living in the city of Bombay. They live in makeshift huts of corrugated iron, plastic sheets, beaten out tin cans, often without water supply or sanitation. The city is overcrowded, unhealthy. It's the most polluted city in the world. Their lives appear to be one long, dreary struggle to survive, made more difficult by the weight of centuries of prejudice, and which often induces a crippling lack of self-confidence. But they do have Dr. Ambedkar. They have his example, and they have his legacy. That legacy is a revived Buddhism. Buddhism offers them the tools whereby they can transform themselves and their lives, bringing happiness and confidence where before there was only drudgery and insecurity. Time and again I saw nervous, diffident people transformed by their experience of meditation, especially on retreat, or transformed by their experience of Sangha, or experience of brotherhood. And their first instinct, having tasted the benefit for themselves, was to want to share it with others. At every talk we gave, we would generate several more invitations, people wanting us to come to their locality or their sister's locality or their son's locality to talk to the people there. Bodhi Sen and I were busy practically every night, going from one locality to another, giving talks. I found other translators so that Bodhi Sen could go off on his own to give talks himself so that we could increase our coverage. Night after night, we would have audiences of hundreds of people, people who perhaps had considered themselves Buddhists for 25 years, but who had yet had no clear idea at all of what that meant. So we explained who the Buddha was. We explained what the Buddha taught. We explained how to practice Buddhist ethics. We encouraged people to come to the classes that we held in hired halls all over Bombay, where they could learn and practice meditation. We encouraged them to come on the retreats that we organized, where they could get a deeper and undistracted experience of Buddhism. Further evidence that this was not just blind faith was the ease with which many people made the transition from what one might call nominal Buddhism to being real Buddhists. That is, people seriously trying to change themselves through the conscious adoption of Buddhist practices such as ethical behavior and meditation. People make this change in India much more easily than we appear able to do in the West. Mainly, I think, because they have this deep reservoir of positive emotion that is easily channeled into an aspiration to transform themselves according to Buddhist ideals. No doubt another factor is that this reservoir of positive emotion is practically all they have got. People lead such hard lives. Poverty, overcrowding, ill health, death, they're all constant companions of the people that live in a city like Bombay. If Buddhism offered them nothing but a little more happiness, a little more dignity, a little more purpose, then I would consider that to be a great boon. Dr. Ambedkar said himself at the time of his conversion, "I feel as I have been liberated from hell. I want you all to experience that for yourselves." But in fact, Dr. Ambedkar's vision went far beyond merely training people to cope with the difficulties of their lives. His vision of a revived Buddhism was an integral part of a wider social vision in which society itself was transformed. The vehicle of that transformation was to be Buddhism. The extent to which this aspect of Dr. Ambedkar's vision has been realized, I will leave Virabhadra to explain to us.
we've heard about Dr. Ambedkar, we've heard about the movement of conversion to Buddhism, which he inaugurated among the ex-untouchables, and we come now to the, one might say, more social aspect of that movement. And we're going to hear about it from Virabhadra. Perhaps I should mention that Virabhadra is not only a member of the Western Buddhist Order, he's also a medical man. I mean, he's a real medical man. And it was partly in that capacity that he spent some 4 years in India, mainly in Pune, but also penetrating into other parts of Maharashtra, indeed into other parts of the country. Virabhadra, like Nagabodhi and like Vajraketu, has quite a number of extraordinary qualities. I don't have time to dwell upon them all, but there's one quality of Virabhadra's that I really would like not to dwell upon, but at least to mention. One particular area, one particular field in which he distinguished himself, which was that despite the fact that he was an Englishman, he learned a foreign language. In the course of his 4 years in India, he became quite fluent. In fact, I think I may say very fluent in Marathi, which is the language of central and western India, the language of the Maharashtrians, the language of the majority of Dr. Ambedkar's followers in that particular part of India. And inasmuch as he didn't need the services of a translator, inasmuch as he could talk directly to people, just ordinary people, people, you know, from the villages, people from the slums, because he started just by asking, well, where is the pain? You know, simple things like that. Eventually he was able even to talk about the Dharma in Marathi, and this obviously brought him very, very close to the people with whom he was living and working and among whom he was moving. Well, he's not going to address us in Marathi this evening, he's going to address us in English. Huh? But I don't know, perhaps he'll just favour you with a few Marathi phrases to create a sort of, you know, local atmosphere. We shall see. Anyway, here is Virabhadra.
Well, thanks very much for that eulogy, Venti. I'm not going to talk in Marathi. The first two speakers have mentioned the fact that Dr. Ambedkar embraced Buddhism, which in many ways was very surprising because there was no established Buddhist community in India when he took that step. And it might be considered to be surprising from a religious point of view, from a spiritual point of view, because it raises very important practical questions. I mean, who is going to teach all these Buddhists Buddhism? Who is going to show them which marriage ceremonies to perform? Who is going to show them which birth ceremonies to perform? Who is going to teach them meditation? Who is going to publish and distribute Buddhist literature? Well, at the time that Dr. Ambedkar converted in 1956, as has been said, there was no Buddhist community in any sort of position to undertake this task. But there was another quite different deficiency, if you like, in the state of the Buddhist community in India at that time. The Buddhist community, such as it was certainly in no position to offer any material support to new converts. And this is an extreme contrast to the position that some of the other religious communities were in at that time. For example, there was a very large and flourishing Christian community which was already heavily engaged in social and educational and medical activities of various kinds through the activities of the missionaries, which had been going on since the very earliest days of colonial penetration into the Indian subcontinent. And you might almost say that the Christians had become experts in the field of social welfare. And indeed, even to the present day, there are a very large number of Christian-sponsored institutions and organisations which are engaged in various kinds of medical and social welfare activities. But there was no such corresponding organisation or source of resources for a new Buddhist movement. So apparently, on the face of it, Dr. Ambedkar took a very strange decision in 1956 when he decided to convert. It's as if he was leading his people blindly into something which was completely unknown. He didn't have anything to offer them in material terms. He couldn't say, if you become a Buddhist, you will get housing, you'll get jobs, you'll get an education, your children will be able to go to medical school. He couldn't say that to them as a concrete and tangible benefit of becoming a Buddhist. And it says an incredible amount for Dr. Ambedkar that he was prepared to take this leap in the dark. It shows what kind of faith he must have had in Buddhism, to believe that simply embracing Buddhism and practicing Buddhism could bring his people out of the extremely dire material conditions that they were living in. And it really is an extraordinary thing to reflect that Dr. Ambedkar was prepared to take this leap in the dark. So he did that. He did convert. He did embrace Buddhism. And his followers were in much the same material condition as they were before they converted. They were still poor. Their children were still excluded from the schools. They were still in a very difficult position as regards health. It was very, very difficult for people to get medical attention. And they were still suffering from the various social stigmas attached to the practice of untouchability. Of course, by this stage, untouchability was being officially cast out from the social system. But of course, in practice, it's something which can't be eradicated overnight, something which is going to take even a lot longer to penetrate throughout the society. It's not something that can be removed, say, by legislation. It's almost an attitude of mind which is going to take a very long time to change. So, ostensibly, Dr. Ambedkar's followers were in no better position than they were before they converted. But that's not the whole story. Dr. Ambedkar was a person with a very broad vision, and he himself had certain very specific ideas as regards progress in the social, educational, and health fields. He wasn't exclusively concerned with political work. He wasn't exclusively concerned at the end of his life even with religious work. He always had a broad concept of the development of the whole society. And this is reflected in the fact that he himself founded a number of social and educational institutions during his lifetime. It's as if he had a concept in his own mind of what sort of social progress there should be among his people. Dr. Ambedkar was someone who worked very much through the law, through the legal system, through the political system. He believed very strongly in government. For example, the efforts that he devoted towards the framing of the constitution and the efforts that he devoted towards the constitutional measures for the uplift of the backward classes show that he had a lot of faith in these measures. He obviously believed that if there were measures to help the backward classes in the governmental system, those measures could and would be effective. Otherwise, presumably, he wouldn't have supported them. But he also felt that these measures were not enough on their own. It was necessary for the backward communities to have their own institutions. It was necessary for them to have, if you like, their own social program for uplift in the various different fields. And he gave practical shape to this feeling by starting a number of institutions. And probably the most important one of these, and the institution which has survived and indeed flourished right up to the present day, is the People's Education Society. This is a trust founded by Dr. Ambedkar, which has been responsible for the establishment of an extremely large number of colleges and schools throughout Maharashtra and indeed throughout India. And if you spend any time in Maharashtra and if you associate at all with Buddhist people, it's almost inevitable that you'll meet people who have been to one of the People's Education Society's schools or colleges. It's very common. You say, oh, where did you do your BA? Oh, I did it at Millen College. You know, oh, where did you do your BCom? Oh, that was in Siddharth College in Bombay. And you meet hundreds and hundreds of people just in ordinary social life who've directly benefited from this particular institution. And there's an element of pride. When someone's telling you that they qualified from such and such a college of the People's Education Society, there's always an element of pride that, yes, this is the institution that was founded by Dr. Ambedkar. This is something that I have received from Dr. Ambedkar. Because of Dr. Ambedkar, I got my education. And there's a very strong feeling of gratitude towards Dr. Ambedkar for having done this. One of the other important organisations that Dr. Ambedkar founded was one with a specifically Buddhist title, and this was the Buddhist Society of India, sometimes known as Bharatiya Baudhama Sabha. And this was Dr. Ambedkar's institution through which he wanted to propagate Buddhism. And it has to be said that from the Buddhist point of view, or from the point of view of Buddhist activities, the Buddhist Society of India has had only a limited impact in propagating the Dharma throughout the very large number of Buddhists. It has to be said that it hasn't managed to educate and propagate the Dharma as systematically as one might have wished. But it's interesting, if we look at the constitution of the Buddhist Society of India, we find that it doesn't just cover the propagation of the Dharma. It doesn't just cover the giving of lectures, the printing of materials on Buddhism. In that constitution, we also find among the aims and objects of the Buddhist Society of India are the founding of hospitals and orphanages. So clearly, this was part of Dr. Ambedkar's social program. Dr. Ambedkar himself wanted the Buddhist community to include these kind of activities in their work. We've had to wait quite a long time for this to actually happen. It's really only since Trailokya Baudhama Sangha, as the Western Buddhist Order is known in India, was able to launch its activities and take up the threads, if you like, of the Buddhist movement, that a systematic social program has begun to take shape. And this is a program which is taking shape alongside the various government measures for social uplift, which are taking place on an increasingly large scale. There are programs in education, there are programs in health, there are programs of social uplift, there are programs of economic development. But these programs need to be complemented, still need to be complemented, by voluntary efforts by Buddhists. They need to be complemented by efforts based on the activities of voluntary organizations. And since 1982, Trailokya Baudhama Sangha Sahat Gana has been undertaking these kind of social and educational activities under the name of Bahujan Hitai. And Bahujan Hitai means for the welfare of the many. And it comes from that famous injunction of the Buddha to go forth for the welfare of the many, for the happiness of the many. And this is the principle on which Bahujan Hitai is based. Very specific projects have been launched. We have the project on which I spent most of my 4 years was a program of health and educational facilities for slum dwellers in Pune. But since I've left India, it seems that the Bahujan Hitai has just been mushrooming in size. The hostel program, which provides secondary school children with living accommodation so that they can attend high school, this program seems to be expanding at a very alarming rate. It seems to be eating out all the funds that can be provided for it, even before those funds have been raised. The Bahujan Hitai social program is seems to be going very well. And there are certain principles which underlie the work. You might say, well, there are lots of charities, there are lots of voluntary organizations, there are lots of government organizations doing this kind of work. Well, what's so special about Bahujan Hitai? Well, I think the thing that's special about it is that it's based on Buddhist values. It's based on Buddhist ideals, which simply the ideal of the welfare of the many. And it's also based on Buddhist people. The Bahujan Hitai activities are all run by people who feel a personal inspiration, some kind of personal link with the principles of Buddhism. They're interested in personal development. They're interested in the welfare of the many. And it's this kind of idealism, this kind of quality of Bahujan Hitai, which makes it rather special. It's meeting real needs. It's meeting needs which can be established through personal contact. Very often we hear of projects which are, if you like, designed in an armchair. You sort of perhaps get a scrap of paper and a bit of pencil and you think, well, we could start an orphanage, or, well, you know, maybe we could start a school or something. And, you know, you just sort of muse, perhaps you have a glass in your hand and you thought, well, we could do it this way or that way. And gradually you start to work out some kind of activity or some kind of building. You say, oh yes, we could have the door, the doors could look like that. And it's like you can design it without any kind of reference to the real situation, without any reference to what's actually going on, without any reference to the way that people actually live and their real needs. But if we follow the principle of direct personal contact, of actually looking, of actually living with people, of actually seeing, then the kind of programs that we formulate are going to be directly relevant to their needs. They're going to be things which actually benefit them in concrete terms. And I think this follows a principle which Dr. Ambedkar himself followed. I mean, he wasn't somebody who lived in isolation from his community. You might think that, he became highly educated. He became a very... at one stage, he himself said that he was the most highly qualified member of the backward classes that had ever been, and I'm sure this is correct. But he wasn't somebody who cut himself off from the masses. He himself used to travel all the time and meet people. He used to visit villages. He used to go around on bullock carts. I mean, he wasn't somebody who kept away from his own community. And we have to bear this in mind. We can't expect to help people if we isolate ourselves from them. We have to be in contact. But it's probably unrealistic to think that something that comes from Britain, something that comes from England, even a Marathi-speaking doctor, it's unrealistic to think that such an individual or even such an organisation can do very much. I mean, India is a very big place. Maharashtra is a very big place. Maharashtra has got a much larger population than Great Britain. It's unrealistic to think that our little organisation, even our world organisation, can solve all the social, economic and spiritual problems of an entire community. But that doesn't make it invalid. Because what we used to see in our work was that, what we were setting up was a kind of, it's a bit of an experiment or even a laboratory. We used to find, or I used to notice, that we used to get quite a few visitors. I mean, people would come and visit Pune, say somebody would come from Nagpur, they'd come and visit Trailoky Badamar Sangha's office, and then just out of interest, they'd come and visit one of the kindergartens that was going on nearby in one of the local slums. And they'd go and have a look, and they'd see the teacher teaching, and they'd see the children playing, and maybe a song would be sung. And the visitor would think, well, that's interesting. Well, I could start something like that in my locality. And this is indeed happening. We're beginning to see now that people are coming, they're having a look, and they're beginning to see that, oh yes, we could do that. And it's the social activities of the kind which are being run by Bahuja Nitai are spreading in this kind of way. They're being spread by people who've come and seen and who are taking the ideas back to their own localities and putting them into practice there. And a lot of this kind of work is not work which involves vast quantities of capital investment. Doesn't necessarily involve a big building. I mean, anybody can start a kindergarten just in the corner of their own house or in the corner of some kind of old temple which has been converted into a Buddhist vihara. So often, it's just giving the idea, it's just giving the way of going about something which is enough. And this seems to fit in very well with Buddhist principles. We're not trying to establish some kind of world domination movement which is controlled by a central computer in Norfolk. It's more a question of just giving people ideas and helping to share ideas and experience, and then, well, people can look after themselves very well. They don't really need us. They don't need me. I'm going to have to learn another language. I think one point which I always like making in talks is that we don't do, or at least I didn't do, one doesn't do, social work in order to attract converts. I mean, this is something which seemed to have been very popular among Christian missionaries, that, if we provide people with education, we provide people with health, if we look after them in various different ways, then they will join our religion. If we get a child when he's in our hostel, when he's age 7, it's the old Jesuit saying, isn't it? But this is not the sort of attitude which we have as Buddhists. We do social work because social work needs to be done. We provide education because educational facilities are lacking. We provide health facilities because those facilities are lacking. And we do it on the basis of actual objective needs, not on the basis of trying to win friends and influence people. Because we don't actually need to do that, particularly we don't need to do that in India, because the friends are already influenced. The friends were influenced by Dr. Ambedkar in 1956. They're all there, they're all Buddhists, and they're already, if you like, we'd be preaching to the converted. So we do the work because it needs to be done. And again, this seems to accord very much with Buddhist principles, that we do something because it needs to be done. We don't have, if you like, an ulterior motive. We're doing something out of our genuine concern for our fellow men and women. And you might think that celebrating a festival connected with Dr. Ambedkar is a rather remote thing. It's something that's it's Indian history, really. It's something that we might read about in our textbook of Indian history, probably in a very small print or in a footnote, that there was this chap called Dr. Ambedkar. But I hope that from this evening we get the impression that Dr. Ambedkar, the work of Dr. Ambedkar, the movement founded by Dr. Ambedkar, is something which has a tremendous significance for us. It doesn't just have significance for India, or it doesn't just have significance for Maharashtra, it doesn't just have significance for people who were once known as untouchables. It has significance for us all. And it seems to me that this significance can be looked at from two points of view. First of all, there is the man himself. It seems to me that Dr. Ambedkar stands for the individual who was an idealist, the person who stood against all social pressure, the man who was able to go against the flow, the man who was able to overcome the limitations of his background and rise above those limitations. Dr. Ambedkar once gave a lecture in which he defined the qualities of a great man. He wasn't talking about himself when he gave this lecture. In fact, he was comparing several characters from Indian history and looking at them to see whether they had the qualities which go to make up greatness. And I won't go through the entire lecture, because that would exhaust my 20 minutes. But I'm just going to summarize the main three qualities that he drew out as constituting a great man. These were, first of all, sincerity, secondly, intellect, and thirdly, that individual should have a transforming effect upon the society. He said that you need to be sincere. If you're a charlatan, if you're working with ulterior motives, then there's no question of greatness. But sincerity on its own is not enough, because there have been many sincere fools, people who've felt that, I'd really like to do something, but what they've done has just been a mess, because they've had no understanding. But intellectual understanding is necessary. We have to have a detailed knowledge, a detailed understanding, a detailed grasp of whatever we're trying to do. But, as Dr. Ambedkar pointed out, even intellect is not enough. Because, well, the world is full of universities. It's full of very clever, highly educated people. And we know that intelligent, highly educated people are not necessarily great. Often, intelligent, highly educated people perpetrate some rather big disasters. So, they perpetrate them rather well. So, sincerity and intellect are not sufficient qualities to define a great man. No, in a way, we can only look at the great man in retrospect. We can only look at his greatness in retrospect. We can only see his greatness by seeing the effect that he has had on the society. And, well, Dr. Ambedkar, by this criterion, was a great man. This is an ideal. The personality of Dr. Ambedkar, his greatness, his sincerity, his intellect, and his transforming effect on the society, these are qualities, these are Buddhist qualities, to which we can aspire. They're part of the cultivation of the true individual. These are parts of our personal spiritual practice. We should be trying to become like Dr. Ambedkar. This is his example. The second way of looking at the significance of Dr. Ambedkar is to look at his movement. We can't separate the spiritual and the material aspects of Dr. Ambedkar's movement. Dr. Ambedkar didn't try and separate them. He didn't say, well, this is my Buddhist movement, this is my educational work, this is my social work. He had a wide vision. He saw how a personal idealism, a personal commitment to Dharma could affect social change, how it could bring about social transformation in the society. He saw it even before it was concrete. He didn't see people meditating. He didn't see 250 people coming on a retreat in Nagpur. He just had faith. He just had his own understanding. He just had his own vision. So, in a way, we can see it. We can see what he's done. We can see the interaction of the spiritual and the material. We can see the impact that this combination can have upon the society. This has been called the Dhamma Revolution. It's not a revolution which comes about through violence. It's not a revolution, if you like, trying to force change. It's a revolution which comes about by applying Buddhist values and Buddhist principles and Buddhist ethics and Buddhist meditation to the society. And this is something that we can actually see happening in the movement of Dr. Ambedkar in India. But this presents a challenge to us. We have a different... We live under different conditions. We work under different conditions. Our conditions of living and working are very easy. We've heard this evening, we've heard something about the material conditions under which people have to work in India. We heard about the nameless Dhammachari who had to live in a corner of odd rooms in Bombay to launch his movement. We're under very different conditions here. We've got gleaming centres with finely polished wooden doors and very nice, beautiful litho, or whatever it is, publications. We've got all the facilities. We've got a video camera recording our every move. In India, if you can get one of those little ordinary little cassette tape recorders, which cost about £10, if somebody can get hold of one of those, if an Indian order member can get hold of one of these little tape recorders, they don't keep it in their house and play pop music on it. They get taped lectures, usually of Sangharakshitas, and they take these tape lectures around with them, around villages. They buy a few batteries and take this little tape recorder, say, to a village, and, well, that's... They give a lecture using this tape recorder. So we're in a position of having all these incredible facilities, all this incredible technology and resources available to us, but we don't really use it. We don't use it to the extent that we really could. In a way, we're not really measuring up to the challenge of Dr. Ambedkar. Perhaps we should think, well, if Dr. Ambedkar was here, if he was coordinating our centre, or if he was giving us some advice on how to run our movement, what would he say? Well, you know, how would he galvanise us into action? Well, I know that Dr. Ambedkar is a very crusty sort of person. You often see representations of him when he's doing this, and he often seemed to be in the position of telling people off. And from what I understand, I've never actually heard his voice recorded, but he generally had rather a terrifying, wrathful sort of aspect. And he was always exhorting people to do more. So perhaps this is the kind of image that we should take home with us tonight. We should be thinking that, well, Dr. Ambedkar is with us and he's challenging us to put into action, to put into practice his Dhamma revolution. Thank you very much. JP.
Many of you, I think, came along this evening knowing very little about Dr. Ambedkar and the movement which he started. Some of you, perhaps, came along knowing nothing about it at all. But I'm sure that, having heard talks by Nagabodhi, Vajraketu and Virabhadra, you begin to get an idea, or you begin to get a better idea, a fuller idea, a richer idea of what that great man achieved for his people. To me, it was an especially interesting experience to sit and listen to them. In fact, it's an especially interesting experience for me to be addressing you at this moment, because, as I mentioned at the beginning, this is the first time that in this country the FWPO has commemorated the death, or indeed any event in the life, of Dr. Ambedkar in this public manner. But in India, just as Vajraketu was, and just as Virabhadra was, and just as Nagabodhi was, for quite a few years, I was doing it all the time. But of course, like them, I was doing it under very different conditions. In fact, I think I can say that inasmuch as I was much earlier on the scene, I was doing it under very, very different conditions indeed. And I couldn't help, just recalling what it was like all those years ago. It's now 25, 30 years ago, when I used to stand up in front of an audience of ex-untouchable Buddhists, sometimes in connection with Vesak, the anniversary of the Buddha's enlightenment, sometimes in connection with Ambedkar's birthday, sometimes in connection with his death anniversary, sometimes in connection with no particular occasion at all. I just happened to be there, so a meeting was organized and I gave a talk. And believe me, it was very, very different. I'm sure you've had some idea of how different it was from the three speakers. But I remember, for instance, that, well, to begin with, we wouldn't be holding the meeting in a hall. It would be almost invariably out in the open, and very late at night. That I think is something that's changed a little since my days. I often used to start delivering my lecture at 11 o'clock in the evening, and I'm a person who likes early hours. And I think my record was when I started speaking at 2 o'clock in the morning. That being, I think, my fifth lecture, that evening, and each meeting had maybe just a little later, because Indians, with all their beautiful qualities, aren't remarkable for punctuality. Here we get a bit agitated if we start a meeting 5 or 10 minutes late. There in India, if it starts 2 hours late, no one minds at all. They just come along in a leisurely sort of fashion. So. Sometimes these meetings were very, very late indeed, at night. And, of course, there'd usually be very, very many more people here. Even in London, if we have 200, 300, 400, 500 people for a Buddhist lecture, even by me, we think they're pretty good. But in India, especially in Maharashtra, I used to be disappointed if there weren't several thousand, and sometimes there were tens of thousands, and even more than that. You just see them stretching back and back right into the darkness. And of course, another difference was that all the men would be sitting on that side and all the women and children on that side, which doesn't, of course, happen in Britain yet. And yes, here we've got just a few fairy lights at the back, just a very few. But if it had been India, the whole place would have been covered with magnificent garlands of fairy lights of all colours. And on a very recent visit of mine to India, I was seated on the platform on I must admit, a sort of throne it was, actually. And behind me was a magnificent shrine with a beautiful Buddha image, and behind the head of the Buddha image was an amazing contraption, a sort of wheel of coloured lights, electric lights, and it was going round and round. All the time that I was speaking, I was just hoping it wouldn't distract people too much from what I was saying. And sometimes I would be the only speaker, but more often there would be some 10 or 12 speakers, and every speaker would be garlanded, and sometimes one would get 20 or 30 garlands. And of course it was quite an occasion. People had been streaming in from neighboring towns and villages, perhaps for this particular talk, this particular lecture. And I was always conscious of an atmosphere of expectancy and excitement. People would be very enthusiastic. There'd be broad smiles on everybody's faces. They'd be really looking forward to whatever it was that you had to say, because perhaps they hadn't heard a proper talk, a proper lecture on Buddhism for years and years, perhaps never before in their lives. As Virabhadra has suggested, we're rather spoiled here in the FWBO, here in this country. Yeah? I can appreciate this because when I first became interested in Buddhism, and this was in London, good heavens, how many years ago is it now? Well, it's about 45 years ago. There were no lectures to go to. There was one little tiny Buddhist organization which held meetings, I think, once a week. About a dozen people attended, and that was all. So I can appreciate how lucky we are now, here in London at least. I can appreciate the importance and value of all the wonderful facilities we have in places like the London Buddhist Center. But in India, they didn't have those facilities, the followers of Dr. Ambedkar, and they don't have them on a very grand scale compared with their actual numbers even today. But whatever they do have, whatever they do get, whatever they are, so to speak, given, they appreciate immensely. I sometimes can't help thinking that in this country, British Buddhists and those interested in Buddhism in this country don't sufficiently appreciate the value of what they're being offered. You can go along any night of the week to the London Buddhist Center, for instance. You can join in the meditation, you can join in a puja, perhaps you can listen to a lecture, you can take part in a discussion. You could even go and have a vegetarian Buddhist meal next door. You can buy Buddhist books. Usually you've got the money to buy them. If you haven't, you think yourself very badly used indeed, and maybe blame the government or grumble about Mrs. Thatcher and her tight-fistedness and all the rest of it. But, you know, we don't appreciate what we've already got, and therefore very often we don't make the very best use of it. But there in India, among our ex-Santashwar Buddhist friends, many of them, I won't say all, that would be an exaggeration, but many of them do appreciate every single word almost of the Dharma that they hear spoken. The Dharma means so much to them. But why does it mean so much to them? Well, perhaps you've got some idea about that already from the previous three speakers, but I feel that very likely most of you haven't got even so a sufficiently strong, a sufficiently vivid, a sufficiently vigorous impression of what Buddhism means to those people. I remember that shortly after the conversion, during those winter tours that I had, going to places like Bombay and Nagpur and Pune and Ahmedabad and Jabalpur and so many others, going to dozens and dozens of villages, the very names of which I've now forgotten, I used to very often ask the newly converted Buddhists whom I met just one question. What difference has it made to you now that you're Buddhists? How do you feel? Whether they were what Indians call educated, or whether they were what Indians call uneducated, which means virtually illiterate, whether they were men or whether they were women, whether they were young or whether they were old, whatever they were, they always gave me, or almost always gave me, just one answer. They simply said, now that we are Buddhists, we feel free. And they meant mainly psychologically free. They felt free from the burden of Hinduism. They felt free from the burden of caste. They felt free from their own previous inferiority. They felt that they were human beings. Because one must remember that before they hadn't been really treated as human beings, they hadn't been regarded as human beings. I mean, think how you would feel if, from the very moment of your birth, you were told you were low, you were no good, you were despicable, you were untouchable, because your very touch spilled pollution. If someone just touched you, they'd have to go and have a bath. If you just looked at their food, they'd have to throw the food away. As for dining with them, that was absolutely unthinkable. Laughable. Well, it wouldn't be laughable to the caste Hindus because they'd regard it as such a very terrible idea. And this is why, at the time when these thousands, these tens of thousands, millions of people renounced Hinduism and became Buddhists, declared themselves as Buddhist, the caste Hindus, in many cases, were not only horrified, not only shocked, but even outraged. Huh? How dare these people give up Hinduism? How dare these people refuse to observe caste? How dare they consider themselves as good as we are? What impertinence, you know, what effrontery, what an outrage for an untouchable to think he's as good as a caste Hindu, as good as a Brahmin. Well, that's blasphemy in the eyes of the orthodox Hindu, because, as one of the previous speakers mentioned, Hinduism, orthodox Hinduism, is a system of graded inequality. If you're born a Brahmin, well, a Brahmin you remain. You can commit all the sins in the Decalogue, or its Hindu equivalent, you're still a Brahmin. You can be an untouchable, and you can be as virtuous as you like, as holy as you like, but you're still an untouchable. It doesn't make any difference. You can't rise. You can't better yourself. But Buddhism maintains, Buddhism teaches, that regardless of caste, regardless of sex, regardless of social position, regardless of race, you can better yourself. And this was the message that Buddhism, through Ambedkar, brought to these ex-untouchables, that you can better yourself socially, better yourself economically, better yourself politically, better yourself educationally, better yourself spiritually. Buddhism, their conversion to Buddhism, gave them the impetus, gave them the energy. It was a sort of catalyst. It was as though the lid had been removed and the steam could come gushing forth. In fact, I sometimes compare the Dharma Revolution, as Virabhadra reminded us it's sometimes called. I sometimes compare that Dharma Revolution to the eruption of a volcano. The red hot lava, the molten lava, just erupts. It bursts into the air. This is what happened. Energy was released, and therefore they felt free. Therefore they felt free. And because they felt free, they could go about bringing about improvement in each and every aspect of their lives. They didn't just feel free, they felt inspired. And Ambedkar himself, on the occasion of the mass conversion, spoke of inspiration. But what is inspiration? Inspiration is the consciousness, if you like. Inspiration is the urge, if you like, to rise to a higher level of development. It is what enables you to rise to a higher level of development. If you believe in the caste system, the hereditary caste system, you can't do that, because as you are born, so you must remain. But according to the Buddhist teaching, that is not so. As you wish, as you strive, so will you become. You can reach even up to the highest spiritual levels. A human being can become even a Buddha. So, to the ex-untouchables, this was really news. Not simply that they could become a Brahmin. After all, what is it to become a Brahmin? That's nothing at all. But you could become a Buddha. You could gain enlightenment. That enlightenment was open. That all possibilities were open to a human being. This was the message that Buddhism through Ambedkar brought to the ex-untouchables. So one can see from this that for the ex-untouchables, then and now, Buddhism means very much more than it often means for many of us. For us, very often, Buddhism is just a rather pleasant way of spending an evening, a little quiet meditation, a little chat with your friends afterwards over a cup of tea, or perhaps a week in the country under rather pleasant surroundings. And you can even hear perhaps people complain that the beds in a particular retreat center aren't quite soft enough, or there's something wrong with the meditation cushions, or the cooking wasn't quite up to standard last week. You don't hear those sort of complaints from our friends in India, I can assure you. They're only too glad that they've got a centre to go along to, or a retreat to go on at all. So for them, as I sometimes say, Buddhism is a matter of life and death. It's really like that. So we have to ask ourselves, whether Buddhism is a matter of life and death for us here in the West, in England, especially perhaps in our welfare state. We do have things very easy in many ways. I'm not saying that it would be a good thing if we had things more difficult, but certainly let's be aware of the facilities that we do enjoy and make the very best possible use of them. Now, I've dwelt a little upon the differences between the situation there and the situation here. But great in importance as they are, those differences are relatively superficial. Whether we are an ex-untouchable Buddhist in Maharashtra, or whether we are a true blue British Buddhist here in London, in England, we go for refuge to the Buddha, we go for refuge to the Dharma, we go for refuge to the Sangha. We practice meditation. We try to observe the precepts, the principles of ethics. We try to improve our relationships with our fellow men. We try to live in harmony with all. We try to improve, at least to some extent, the society in the midst of which we live. We have all these things in common. And because we have so much in common, we can feel a sort of unity, even, with our fellow Buddhists, our friends, in Maharashtra, in places like Bombay and Nagpur and Pune, about which we've been hearing this evening. We can feel even our unity with them. And this surely is a very important thing, not just from the standpoint of Buddhism and spiritual life, but even from the standpoint of world affairs. Because nowadays so many barriers, it seems, are being erected. Nowadays you can fly from one part of the world to another in a matter of hours. But nonetheless, at the same time, it's much more difficult to do that because you have to go through all sorts of formalities. You need a passport, you need a visa, all that sort of thing. Which means that though in one sense the world has become, yes, a smaller place, in another sense perhaps it's just as big as ever it was, or perhaps even bigger. There's lots of our Indian friends would perhaps like to come and spend some time with us in Britain, but it isn't always easy. They don't always find it easy to get that all-important visa. I for one certainly look forward to the day when there will be no such things as visas, and perhaps even no such things as passports. I don't know whether I shall live to see that glorious day, but perhaps, some of you will. I don't know. And then perhaps we can just, those who feel so inclined, just go from one country, especially from one Buddhist country to another, meeting our friends everywhere and feeling, experiencing our unity and our solidarity with them. Well, in a way, we've been able to do that this evening, thanks to the three talks which we've heard. Many of us perhaps have not been to India, perhaps we never will go. But I'm sure, while our three speakers were actually speaking, we actually felt that we were there, that we were with those ex-untouchable Buddhists, that we were with those followers of Dr. Ambedkar, and perhaps even that in a sense we were with the great Dr. Ambedkar, whose 30th death anniversary we're celebrating this evening, himself. Well, that isn't the end. Somehow I've got to get to Nagabodhi, because Nagabodhi is going to have, so to speak, another go. I'm afraid I can't say very much more about it. I can't really tell you what he's going to talk about, for reasons which are perhaps just a wee bit embarrassing. So perhaps I better just hand you over directly to Nagabodhi, who in his own incomparable way is going to talk to you about, just very, very briefly, about some other little matter.
you, Bhante. Well, this evening, and I'm not being falsely modest, I don't think, seems to have got better and better and better as it's gone along. And during the course of it, I hope by now you feel you've had at least a brief overview of the significance, the importance of Dr. Ambedkar in Indian history, in Buddhist history, in world history, in our own history. I hope you will agree with me now, with all of us now, that he is more than just an interesting figure. He's an extremely important figure. So I hope this evening has been enough to stimulate your interest in him and to stimulate your appetite for more information about him. And if the evening has had that effect, then I hope you will buy a copy of this book entitled Ambedkar and Buddhism, written by the Venerable Sangharakshita. It will be on sale almost instantly.
Why almost?
They've got to open the boxes. Sangharakshita has not mentioned, I don't think, this evening, that he knew Dr. Ambedkar. He met him on several occasions and corresponded with him during the 50s. Dr. Ambedkar actually asked Sangharakshita to perform his own conversion ceremony. In the event, Sangharakshita didn't. He had better advice to give, as you'll read in the book. Sangharakshita spent many years working with Dr. Ambedkar's followers during the years after his death, as we've just heard, wandering around from towns to villages to cities, meeting the new Buddhists, giving hundreds of lectures and talks, keeping alive Dr. Ambedkar's movement. Years later, he inspired the founding and the development of Trilokya Bodh Mahasangha Sahayak Gana, the new movement that has been founded in India, which is now working with Dr. Ambedkar's followers, and out of which has arisen Bahujan Hitai, which we heard about a little while ago from Virabhadra. So Sangharakshita has been intimately and deeply and passionately involved in the life and vision and work of Dr. Ambedkar. And this book offers an invaluable assessment of Ambedkar's thinking on Buddhism, Ambedkar's attitude towards Buddhism, and his reasons for conversion, and therefore of the significance of the conversion movement in India and here. I've read it, I'm happy to say, and it's an extremely readable book, and as I'm sure you can imagine, having just heard Sangharakshita's concluding remarks, it's a heartfelt book, a passionate book. So I hope when you get up from your seats, you will go straight to the table at the back of the room and out in the foyer where the book will be on sale. There will be tea being served, so I hope you're not going to stampede off into the night. Please stay around, drink tea, and look at the book and buy the book. For one night only, a book which normally will cost you £5.95 is going to cost £4.80. And if you like this sort of thing, if this sort of thing helps you to buy, to identify and connect, then Sangharakshita has let me know that he's prepared to sign any copies of the book that anybody wants to present to him. I think there's little more to say than Jai Bim.
Nagabodhi. Thank you, Vajraketu. Thank you, Virabhadra. And thank you, everybody, for coming.